you're constantly struggling to know what in the world God is trying to say to you, and it sounds like gibberish to you, and you're trying to figure out, why won't God just speak to me in a language that I can understand? Now, we have already established why is that, and we've been talking about that in this series of Fixable in these last several weeks. And we've already established the fact that part of the problem is that we're separated from God. That God created us with perfect communication in the cool of the day, perfect fellowship with God. We had all of this going for us. And then somewhere in the middle of that, He gave us this wonderful but dangerous gift of free will. And at some point, Adam and Eve exercised that free will. And as a result of that choice, we lost communication and fellowship. And instead of being able to communicate with the God who created us, we end up in the bushes hiding and trying to cover ourselves and try to not to have a conversation with Him. And He has to come looking for us in our lives. And it was not enough then for Adam and Eve to have sinned, but something happened drastically, because at that moment we became broken beings, separated from God because of our sin, deprived of a relationship with Him, depraved in our heart, not even sure we want a relationship with Him anymore, because He becomes a fearful being instead of a God who we want to love and be with in our lives. And so we become totally broken in our lives. But it doesn't just break us because of the act, but we discover that sin has done three things to us. It's intruded our world and created in us a sin nature. Something has become twisted and different inside of us because of sin. And as a result of that, then we commit acts of sin, deliberate acts of sin against the known law of God. But there's one more thing that sin has done. But because of all of us have choices and all of us make choices, then the choices that we make affect others. And so we end up hurting each other. And when we're young, those choices end up hurting us to the point that we cannot hear or understand what normal is, and we become wounded by the sin of others and arrested in our development and our ability to understand that. That's what we have discovered in the last couple of weeks as well. But the good news is that Jesus Christ came, and when He came and gave His life on the cross as a sacrifice for sin, He dealt with both of those, all of those sin problems. By His stripes we are healed, we are forgiven. He has forgiven us our past sins. And not only does He forgive us our past sins, but He begins to change something in us so that our nature can come back to be like Christ. And that's what He came. The wonderful news is that He made it possible for us to start over. To turn over a new leaf, to begin a whole new life, to be forgiven in our lives. But that only changed sin problem number one. As we talked about last week, we needed sin problem number two taken care of. What we do with this twisted heart. And the good news is that the same experience of the atoning blood of Jesus Christ made it possible for us to be cleansed from a self-centeredness and a sin nature and a self-sovereignty in our lives, so that we can, as we talked about last week, we can come as believers and present our bodies, our whole being, as a living sacrifice. We talked about that with the whole surgery thing. And we present ourselves, and then He comes and cleanses us from all sin in our lives. And He rewires our minds, and He begins a transforming process in that makes it happen. Now, how does that happen in our lives? Well, it happens because of the work of the third person of the Trinity. Jesus did the work in providing it. He made the provision for it. But Pentecost and the giving of the Holy Spirit makes this possible so that you and I can actually realize it. And this was God's plan from the beginning, because He kept telling through His prophets, He kept telling this story over and over again. For instance, look at Ezekiel chapter 36. Here's what He said. I'm going to sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. Your filth will be washed away, and you'll no longer worship idols. And I'll give you a new heart, and I'll put a new spirit in you. And I'm going to take out your stony, stubborn heart and give you a tender, responsive heart. And I will put My spirit in you so that you will follow My decrees and be careful to obey My regulations. Then the prophet Joel, chapter 2. Here's what God said. I'm going to pour out my spirit upon all people. It's coming. Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your old men will dream dreams. And your young men will see visions. And in those days, I will pour out my spirit even on servants, men and women alike. So here is the promise that the prophets have been talking about for all this time. Then Jesus comes. And Jesus, after his death and resurrection on the cross, he gathers his disciples on a mountain, getting ready to go back to heaven. And here's what he says. He says, I'm going away, but I'm not going to leave you as orphans. I'm going to leave you alone. I'm going to send you somebody else. I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit, who will become front and center in your relationship with God. He's the one that's going to affect and make possible everything that I did for you. He's going to apply it to your life. He becomes the agent. And he promises them, not only will you be baptized with water, that there's been a change in your life, but I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit, who will not just be with you. He's going to live in you. And he's going to baptize you with fire power in the innermost being. And he's going to be in you 24/7 in your life, as a new source of presence and power in your lives. That was Jesus' problem. So the promise. So the disciples went back and they obeyed. They were in the upper room for 10 days. They were praying. There was this unifying experience. They'd been bickering and fighting and arguing about who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom and who's going to do this and who's going to do that. And they're all at odds with each other. But somewhere in that prayer meeting in 10 days in the upper room, there came this unifying presence. And it says the Holy Spirit came upon them, Acts chapter 2. And when the Holy Spirit came upon them, there was cloven tongues of fire that came down and sat on their heads. That's what it looked like to each other. And there was this rush of mighty wind, which, by the way, was the very symbols that happened at Mount Sinai when God gave the Ten Commandments to Israel. Wind and fire and all of the things, the symbols. Same thing at Pentecost. And the Holy Spirit was given to them. And the Word says that the Holy Spirit filled every one of them. And they began to be able to speak even in other languages, the gospel of Jesus Christ, so that everybody could understand what was happening in their lives. And Peter, some months later, he's reflecting on this experience, and he said, oh, by the way, not only did we see fire and wind, and not only did we have the ability to share the gospel with others, even those who didn't know our language, but the Holy Spirit, came and purified our hearts by faith. There was something that drastically took place on the inside. So we have this model of living in the fullness and the presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Why do we need that? It was not enough that Jesus died on the cross. Why do we need the Holy Spirit in Pentecost? For this reason. You can put it in your notes this morning. I've given it to you. And if you get nothing else this morning, I trust that this will come across more than anything else that I may say this morning. Here it is. It's simply this. The human spirit fails unless the Holy Spirit fills. The human spirit fails unless the Holy Spirit fills. Why? Because God is holy and His nature is holy. He's the only one that is ultimately holy. All other holiness derives from God. There is no holiness. There is nothing holy that is not connected to God, who defines holy. It's His nature to be holy. It's the way that He is. He is not weakened and damaged by the power of sin. He doesn't have a gap between what He wills and getting it done. You and I are different. By nature, because of sin, we are not holy. So therefore, I have this desire, but I have this problem because there's this gap between my desire to be holy and to be godlike and pulling it off. As Frank Moore has said very clearly, good intentions, we all have good intentions, but a lot of time good intentions do not translate into good actions. We have this gap that takes place in our life. Now, I want to illustrate that just a moment this morning because of our brokenness and what has taken place. Caleb, it's good to have you back. Would you come and help me out here this morning? I promise you it won't hurt. And you won't be embarrassed past noon. And then I need a woman or a teenage woman. Anybody? Any girls? Give me a hand. Huh? Yeah? Come ahead. Yeah. Now I want to demonstrate something to you. Let's hope this works. I tried it. Don't try this at all. No. Here's what I want you to do. I want you to come first. Now, what I'm going to have you do, Lydia, now you can't go to sleep in this exercise, okay?
I won't.
Oh, okay, good. What I want you to do is just lean over like this till your head is against the table. I'm going to hold it up. And when your whole weight is on your head, I want you to put your hands behind your back. Can you do that? Can you do that?
No.
You can't do that? You won't fall. You're not sure about this? Okay. Anybody else? Nicole, come here. I tested her earlier. Now, Nicole's going to put all of her weight and her head is on this table, hands behind her. Yeah. All right. Now, can you stand up straight? She can stand up straight. Yeah, give her a hand. Wasn't that good? All right. Now, Caleb, you're going to do the very same thing.
I don't know about this.
Make sure, and you won't fall. Just bring your head over here. Put your head there, and get your feet apart till your weight's on your head. Till your weight. Yep. That's good. Okay. Now, can you get up? Stand back a little bit. Come back. There you go. Now. Can't do it. Could help? Yeah, you moved your feet. What does that illustrate? If you, the center of gravity is absolutely right. You women can do that because naturally, you're designed to be able to do that. We men can never, if we put our weight there, it will never, ever happen that we can pull ourselves up by ourselves. We have to have somebody, we'd have to shift our feet, we would have to have somebody to help us do that. That is exactly the way it is with a holy God who is natural. He is holy, and we, separated from God, leaning into our self-centeredness, no matter how much we want to, no matter how much we strain our muscles, no matter how much we try to stand up straight and live holy in our lives, we cannot do that by ourselves. That's what we begin to discover. And if we try to imitate it, and some of us do, sometimes we try to imitate God, and then we throw up our hands because we cannot pull it off in our lives because I have this fallen nature. So then what happens when I can't pull off this holy living and I can't imitate God? Then I go into this negative self-talk. I start beating myself up. I throw up my hands. I say, I can't do this. I can't live it. And one of the greatest challenges for us is that this doctrine that we talk about in the scripture that talks about being holy and being like God, we figure we can't be that because we've tried really, really hard. We've done everything we could to straighten up and to stand up straight and to live the way God wants us to live. And we cannot do it because we don't have the nature to be able to pull that off in our lives. And that's why Jesus sent us the Holy Spirit. But the Holy Spirit, the problem is that we don't tap in to the Holy Spirit's presence in our lives. Even though He has been given to us as believers, we don't consciously tap into that in our lives. In fact, many of us relate to the Holy Spirit as some kind of a force in our lives rather than a person to have a relationship with, a 24/7 relationship in our lives. And so when we come to this place where the Bible says in Ephesians, "Be ye imitators of God," we look at that and go, how am I supposed to pull that off? I can't imitate God. I can't be like Him. And we try and we fail. That's why Jesus promised that the Holy Spirit would make the difference in our lives. Now, I want you to go to John chapter 14. We're going to look at this because here's where Jesus promised in very specific terms what this Holy Spirit, this helper, would do for us and be for us as believers and followers of Jesus Christ. In fact, it's called, theologians, Bible scholars, call it the five paraclete. I didn't say parakeet. This is not a pet store, a menagerie. This is the paraclete. And that word is rich with meaning in the Greek language. It means to have a counselor, a comforter, an advocate, or the term I want to land on this morning is the term helper. The Holy Spirit is our help desk, is our inner help desk in our lives that God has given to us. It literally means one who comes alongside. That's the role of this Holy Spirit. And He's not a force. He is a person like you and I. He's in the Trinity. So what does this mean for you and me? What kind of a helper is this person of the Holy Spirit in our lives? What kind of a helper when we are struggling and beating ourselves up, and when we are struggling in our lives to be like God wants us to be and seeking to live this life? How do we do it? What do we do when Satan comes and has a heyday by accusing us and pointing out all of our failures in our lives? And the reality is sometimes we do blow it. It's not even trying. Sometimes we sin. We deliberately go against what we know to be God's laws in our lives. And we've learned to live in that. And we struggle with our past. Sometimes we need a teacher. Because I don't know how to live. I try it and I need someone to come along and say, you know, you got the right tool, but you're not using it properly. I need someone to do that in my life. Sometimes we need a helper who's honest with us and will tell us the truth about ourselves, even if it hurts. I need a helper like that sometimes in my life. Sometimes I need someone who can make sense of all the confusion and the anger and the division going on in the world and in my life and in my family. I need a helper like that. I need a helper who can lead and guide me to the truth about the future. When I don't know what's coming next in my life, I need a helper who can say, this is the way, go this way. Don't do this, do this. And how do I begin to do that? Well, Jesus described this helper, and I want you to see it this morning in John chapter 14 through 17. In fact, this whole sermon that he preaches just before he gets ready to go away, 3 or 4 chapters long, and he begins to talk to them about this helper. And the first thing he says about this helper is that he is an advocate. What does that mean? Well, in this case, it says he stands with you and he presents the truth. Look at John 14, 15. If you love me, Jesus said, you will obey my commands. And I will ask the Father, and he'll give you another helper, advocate, to be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. Now, the picture here is you're in the courtroom, and you're standing before the judge, and you had all the good intentions in the whole wide world, but you failed to measure up to the perfect law of God. What do you need? You need an attorney. You need a paraclete. You need a helper. You need an advocate. Why? Because the advocate knows the law. The advocate knows all the parts in the inner workings, and he knows the purpose of the law, and he studied the law. And you need someone who can stand beside you and present the truth of the law, but also reveal to the judge the motive of your own heart. He stands as your advocate and your helper in behalf of what you need. He knows our hearts. That's what the Bible teaches us. Here's what the Bible says. God knows people's hearts, and He confirmed that He accepts the Gentiles by giving them the Holy Spirit just as he did to us. Did you catch that? God knows our hearts, and he gives us this advocate, this helper, who comes to speak in our behalf. He knows how to argue the motives of the heart. Now, this isn't just a get-out-of-jail-free card where the Holy Spirit shows up to get you out of a continual mess where you just keep messing up over and over again. Can you? I've known some people like that. I've known some people that hired a lawyer and retained a lawyer 24/7 because they planned on being in trouble with the law all the time. They just lived that way. Now, can you imagine if you had a lawyer and you stand before the judge and the lawyer argues your case and you are acquitted and you get free of that, but you keep going back to the same place, doing the same mistakes, falling in the same place and falling into the same chuck holes and falling into the same problems, and you keep coming back to your lawyer and say, can you get me off of this one? Can you get me off of this one? Can you get me off of this one? What would your attorney finally say to you? Well, Jesus said what the Holy Spirit is going to say. The Holy Spirit's going to say, if you love me, why don't you start keeping my commandments? I'm here to get you free, but this is not I expect you to begin to live. If you love me, keep my commandments, and the Holy Spirit will become your helper who will help you in the places where you have failed, but you need help, and it's not intentional. 1 John 2:1, John, dealing with the same thing, said, my children, I'm writing this to you because the whole idea of this thing is that you will learn not to sin. You have a choice not to sin. You can actually live by making a choice not to sin. And then he said this. He said, but if you do sin, we have an advocate, a helper with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And Jesus has delegated this advocacy to the Holy Spirit who works in us to help us in these areas. So we have an advocate. We have a helper who is an advocate in our behalf. But Jesus said another thing. He said this advocate, this helper, will be like a coach to you. And the coach will remind you of the truth. That's what a coach does. Coach comes along, listens to where you're at, understands your weaknesses and your strengths, knows how to put that all together, and then he works with you to build your potential in the game. We were at the energy game last night, and they actually won. I guess that's kind of a rare thing for the energy right now, but they won. And I was fascinated as I was thinking about this morning. I've been thinking about this passage of Scripture. I watched the coaches for a while, just because I knew I was going to talk about this morning. I watched those coaches. Fascinating thing. I saw one coach in the middle of the game where a guy had come down on the basket, one of these tall guys, about 7 foot something or other, and he had fouled at a very critical moment when he's not supposed to be fouling, and it was not a part of the strategy of the game. And I saw this. I don't know exactly what the coach said, but the coach comes over and yells at him and comes up close to the sideline to get as close to him as he could. And he yells at him. And then all I saw was he said, he went like he made this body motion. He goes, I have no idea what all that means, except I think he was telling him, don't spread out, because that's what created the foul. He was saying, stand stationary. Coach that helps them find their direction in their life. And this coach knows how to bring soothing and comforting words and gentleness when we are attacked by the enemy, but he also knows how to give us a kick when we need it to get us back into the game and to get us to thinking about what we need to do. Look at what Jesus said about this helper in John 14:26. But the helper will cause you to remember all that I've told you. This helper is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. Now, when you think about it, without the Holy Spirit, Jesus and his teachings would be a distant memory for a lot of us. In fact, I would dare to say that there's probably some of us who went all the way through this week and didn't think about much about the teachings of Jesus. It's a distant memory. It would be in the past. It's something we learn in Sunday school, but it's not something that's up to date at the moment in our lives. And Jesus says, this helper will remind us You see, Christianity is not like other religions. We don't try to remember what Muhammad said. We don't try to remember what some other religious leader said. This is not about us remembering this. Jesus said, I'm giving you a helper who's going to live in you, be with you 24/7, and he is going to remind you. He's going to bring this into the fresh, into the present. He's going to bring everything that I taught and the way I lived, he's going to bring it into the present moment to apply it to your life. Christ becomes the very essence of our lives because the Holy Spirit teaches. That's why Paul could say in Colossians 1, Christ is in you. He is your life. He's not a part of your life. He doesn't intersect your life. He isn't coming to be to talk to you once in a while in your life. Paul said he becomes your life. Well, how does that happen? With the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is the coach. But next, Jesus said he's not only a coach, but he is a teacher. And I need a teacher sometimes. Look at John 14:26 again. But the helper will teach you everything. This helper is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. So all the miracles, all the lifestyle, all of the things that Jesus taught us, everything that's going on in our lives, in our lifestyle, Jesus said the Holy Spirit comes to teach us how to apply the Jesus life into the everyday living of our lives. Now, it's a common thing. Some of you may be in it. But right now, community adult education is huge. Do you get the foldouts in the mail? Do you get the little banners on the side of your computer, the advertisements, community colleges? Huge. But I want to tell you this morning that the Holy Spirit has been in the education business for believers since Pentecost. He is working for education in our lives. He sums up the whole purpose. And in fact, Paul said it well when he wrote to the Philippians, and he said, everything else in my life has become like barnyard rubbish, except for one thing. Now, that's a pretty big statement. Everything in my life has become second. Barnyard rubbish in value and comparison. There's nothing that measures up to it, but one thing. What's the one thing? I want to know Christ. I want to know the power of his resurrection, Paul said. I want to know the fellowship of his, this is the one we don't like so well. I want to know the fellowship of his sufferings. I want to know how to suffer like Jesus suffered. I want to know Christ. Well, how do we know that? Well, we need a teacher. We need a teacher like our mothers were, who don't just nag us, but who show us and teach us. Social scientists, psychologists tell us that we only remember about 7% of what we hear. Now, that helps a preacher a whole lot. Because I know by this afternoon, this evening, you can't name half your points. And the truth is, I can't get past lunch, and sometimes I can't remember the points. Because 7%. That's why the Bible calls preaching in human thinking foolishness. Did you know that? The Bible says the foolishness of preaching. And then it says that God chose it on purpose, the foolishness of preaching. Now, why would he choose the foolishness of preaching in which you're only going to get 7% of it? Why would God choose that? That doesn't really build anybody's ego when you think about it. So what am I doing up here? If that's the case, do you know why the only way that that works? Is because of the Holy Spirit. See, the Holy Spirit, you won't remember, but the Holy Spirit, if you're listening and taking in, and the notes and the things that we do and the visuals that we do and illustrations that we do, all of that is the communication process, because when you're gone, you won't remember it, but the Holy Spirit, if you'll tune into his presence in your life, he has a way of bringing to you in remembrance what you heard that you wouldn't have heard, you wouldn't have remembered, and he reminds you of the things which you have heard. Well, how do you do that? Well, You have to be filled with the Spirit. Because see, what we're learning here is, and science says it, the human spirit fails unless the Holy Spirit fills. The human spirit will fail unless the Holy Spirit fills. I need a teacher. But I also need a helper who is a witness and a prosecutor. Really? Well, let's look at John 15. Jesus said, I'll send you the helper from the Father. He is the Spirit of truth who comes from the Father. And when He comes, He will tell about Me. And you also must tell people about Me because you have been with Me from the beginning. Let me ask you a question. When is the last time that you consciously, on purpose, nudged by the Holy Spirit, talked to someone else about what Jesus has done for you in your personal life? Was it this week? Has it been months? When's the last time, seriously, think about this, that you, on purpose, had a conversation with somebody about what Jesus has done in your life? Jesus said that when the Holy Spirit comes, He will talk about Me, and you also must tell people about Me because you have been with Me from the beginning. Now, why did Jesus say to us, I'm going to give you the Holy Spirit who's going to nudge you to talk to someone about Me? If you go days and weeks and you never have an opportunity to tell somebody about Jesus, does it bother you? Does it really bother you? Oh, well, they can come when they, you know, we got the church open every Sunday. They can show up when they want. They want to hear the good news. It's available. It's on radio and television. They, you know, yeah, I'll talk to somebody about it if they ask me about it, but, you know. Why did Jesus say this? Why did He give us the Holy Spirit? Because He tells us in chapter 16 why. The Holy Spirit is working on people's lives all around you as the prosecutor. Watch this. But He can't prosecute if He doesn't have a witness. Guess who the witness is? You and me, filled with the Holy Spirit. We are the witnesses, so the prosecutor can say, yeah, you remember when your friend told you this? Here's the truth. Look at what Jesus said. He said, when I go away, I'm going to send you this helper. If I don't go away, the helper will not come. When the helper comes, here's what his job is. He's going to convict or prove to the people of the world the truth about their sin and about being right with God and about the judgment. He's going to prove to them that their sin is not believing in Me, and He's going to prove to them that being right with God comes from My going to the Father and not belong and not being seen anymore. And the helper will prove to them that judgment happened when the ruler of this world was judged. That sounds like the opening statement in a courtroom, doesn't it? Prosecuting attorney gets up and goes in front of the jury and he says, I aim to prove to you that this person did this and this and this and this, and it was premeditated and da 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 da. And what's he going to do? How is he going to prove that? He's going to say, I'm going to call this witness to the stand and this witness to the stand, and here is evidence, and here is all of it together, and convince the jury that the conviction is right. Jesus said that's exactly the role of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We are the witnesses called, subpoenaed into the courtroom on earth with all of these folks who are guilty of sin. We've been subpoenaed to give witness to what Jesus did on the cross and what He's done in our lives so that the Holy Spirit can do His job as a prosecutor when they go to bed at night and they wake up in the middle of the night and the Holy Spirit is there and they remember the conversation they had with you that day. and the Holy Spirit begins to work in their life, yeah, what are you going to do about that? Maybe you ought to go to church and check that out. Maybe you ought to listen to your friend. And then they come back and you're shocked because they say, you know, when you were talking about that the other day, I was thinking about that. Do you have a Bible? Or they may say something similar to that in their lives. The Holy Spirit. And that's what Jesus meant when he said to his disciples in Acts chapter 1 verse 8, when I go away, I'm going to send you the Holy Spirit, and he will empower you to be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and the uttermost parts of the world. And the word that he used for the power of witness is the word that we get the word, English word, dynamite or dynamo. Jesus said, I'm gonna create something explosive in you and something that generates ongoing power in you so that you can be the witnesses that I need to be, so that my Holy Spirit can prosecute sin so that people will come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. You say, well, why don't God just figure it out himself? Well, you remember when he talked about a week or so ago that God limited himself by giving us free will. Here's the other crazy thing. I don't understand this. But God, the God of the universe, seldom does anything without us. We either have to respond or cooperate. And if we don't respond or cooperate, God says, I could, but I'm not going to. Now, he has his part that we can't do, and he comes in and helps that. But he many times won't do his part until we're doing our part. And that's why he sent this powerful Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit comes and does, and Jesus said, when the Holy Spirit comes, you're going to be doing greater things than I even did. Now that blows my mind. How can we do greater things than Jesus? That's how we got our name, Greater Life. It's about being and living the greater life in Christ and doing greater things like Jesus promised. Well, how does that happen? It happens with the fullness of the Spirit, because the human spirit fails unless the Holy Spirit fills. And how do we begin to live this greater life that is in Christ? How could he do that? Well, Jesus was saying, I've come and done my part, died on the cross, gave you an example, showed you how to do it. Now I'm going to go away because there isn't much more I can do about that. Me physically being with you isn't going to help you. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit to live in you so that you can go to every nation that I won't be able to go to physically. You're going to get to talk to people in the next generations that I won't get to talk to personally. You become my body. You become my church. You become my feet and hands. You literally become my presence in the world. How do you do that? Through the power of the Holy Spirit. That's why the early church, think about it, these little ragtag disciples fighting and fussing among themselves, two of them had the nickname of the sons of anger, the sons of thunder. Peter sticking his foot in his mouth all the time saying stupid stuff. The zealots who were politically motivated, they were trying to create riots in the streets and demonstrations every day in Jerusalem. They were called dagger men because they all carried a weapon in their cloak in anticipation that a fight would break out and they could have a revolution and overthrow the government. They lived that way. That was their philosophy. That was their political philosophy. And Jesus chose one of them as a disciple. Crazy. What was he thinking? And you had this ragtag bunch, and then when Jesus goes to the cross and he gets arrested, what did they all do? Did they stand up and fight for him? Well, Peter tried. He took a sword out and chopped the guy's ear off. And Jesus said, whoa, Peter, that's not the way we're going to do this. But what did the rest of them do? The Bible says they all ran away. And the guy who chops off the ear ends up at a fireplace denying that he's ever been with Jesus ever. And he cusses to create the strength that I never knew him, and denies him. And Judas went out and betrayed him. You know why he betrayed him? Because of his political philosophy. He thought Jesus was going to be the Messiah king who would overthrow the Roman government. And he thought that by paying off the chief priests, that he would force Jesus to get an army and march against Rome. He thought he was doing a favor politically to Jesus. And here he is. This is the group that now meets in the upper room, and Jesus is counting on them to take the good news of the gospel. They can't even get along. It's a wonder they even made it to the upper room to spend time together. They didn't like each other. They get to that upper room. And this Frank Moore says it well. He says this ragtag, bickering, carnal, self-seeking, hiding followers who are scared of their own shadows. And yet, they turn the Roman Empire on its ear. And that's why you're here this morning. Because this crowd got filled with the Holy Spirit. And they began to tell people about Jesus. You see, when the Holy Spirit comes, He brings this power for service, and He ends the struggle with self-sovereignty and stress of self-effort, and He brings a peace that's entire, and He brings a witness, and He verifies with our spirit, and He gives us something to talk about in our life. He becomes the witness and the prosecutor, and He wants us to carry the role of witness so He can prosecute. Well, nobody ever gets saved in my family. Nobody ever gets saved in my neighborhood. Nobody ever comes to Christ in my workplace. Could it be that the reason is that you've never been the witness yet? And the Holy Spirit's walking all through the cubicles and He's walking through the relationships in your family, but He's looking for a witness so He can prosecute. And we're going, well, you do that on your own. I'm not coming. A witness and a prosecutor. But then Jesus said, lastly, that the Holy Spirit would be a guide, and I need a guide. What kind of a guide? Jesus said that this guide, the Holy Spirit, would lead us to all truth. Now watch this. Look at John chapter 16, verse 13. When the Spirit of truth comes, He will guide you into all truth. Wait a minute, I'm confused. Because Jesus said, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. Didn't we all get it all in Jesus? Isn't that enough? We got all we needed in Jesus. Jesus is the truth. And yet He's saying He's still going to lead us into all truth. Well, what more truth could there be? I already got Jesus. Well, let's see what we can find out. He will not speak on His own, but will tell you what He has heard. Oh, here we go. He will tell you about the future. He will bring me glory by telling you whatever He receives from me. All this belongs to the Father's mind. This is why I said the Spirit will tell you whatever He... Oh, wait a minute. You mean this isn't 2,000 years ago, past tense? The Bible, we have the Bible, and that's all we got? And this is what we're going on? And this is it? No. Jesus said, there's a whole lot more. In fact, He told His disciples right here in this passage, in this sermon. He said, there's a whole lot I can't tell you. I don't have time, and you aren't ready to take it. You can't handle it. But when He, the Holy Spirit, comes, when the right time comes, He will be able to take what I've, remind you of what I've said, and then He's going to take it further because you're going to face some stuff that you don't even know what you're going to face. But the Holy Spirit's going to be there to tell you about the future and to tell you how to act in the future based on what Christ has done in the past. So He's going to tell you things you've never known before. He's going to tell you things about your future. He's going to give you something to work with in your life. He provides insights into the future. You want an example of that? We do have a written example of that. It's in the book of Revelation. John was allowed, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day. Remember that? And he said, the heavens opened, and I was transported into the heavenlies. And God began to show him into the future, and every one of those words. Now you have to get past the symbolism, and why did he talk in all those symbols? Because he couldn't get it past the postal system of the Roman Empire if it had sounded too religious. because it would have been a threat to the Roman Empire. So you know what he did? He used Old Testament imagery and symbols out of Daniel and Ezekiel, because if the Jewish people were schooled in the Word of God and understood the Old Testament, they would catch on to what was being said in the symbolism of Revelation. So you want to understand the book of Revelation? You can't understand the book of Revelation unless you've studied the book of Daniel and Ezekiel before that. Because it's written in the symbolism and a code so the Roman Empire wouldn't get it, but the people of God would be able to decode it and figure it out. And in the Spirit, John saw. And it's the same Holy Spirit that Jesus said will be a guide to every one of you, and he will tell you the things you need to know for the future in living in the world that you're living in. He provides that insight. He's the help desk. He's the advocate. He's the advisor, the counselor, the teacher. Now, how do you connect with that and live in the flow of it? Well, let's get real personal this morning. You came here in your minds this morning while I'm preaching. You're thinking about, some of you have been thinking about some struggles you got right now. What am I going to do this week about that and this and the other thing? Some of you are here this morning and you don't know whether, you just feel guilty, you feel bad because some things haven't worked out and you're wondering, is it my fault or is it somebody else's fault or what's my responsibility or how am I going to handle this or what am I going to do with this and where do I go and how do I get the help that I need? And you need a counselor, you need a guide. You're saying, some of you come in here and said, I don't know what I'm going to do in the future. I don't know what I'm going to do with that medical situation. I don't know what I'm going to do with my aging parents. I don't know. I don't know what the next step is. I'm not sure about retirement. I'm not sure about the test I've got to take this week in school. I don't know. I wonder who. I wonder sometimes who I'm going to marry. Will I even get to marry? You're struggling with all those kinds of things. You're looking for the guide. What would happen if you became 24/7 conscious of what Jesus promised, that you have a help desk internal, the Holy Spirit, who literally is at work in every one of those decisions in your life? Would it make any difference? A while back, I was questioning some things. And I was wondering if what I'm doing is what I need to be doing, or if I need to be doing something else, or going somewhere else or doing something different. And this was going through my head. I was saying, Lord, you know, this is all confusing, right? I need help. I need some kind of confirmation. I need you to speak into my life. And now when I pray that, then I got to start looking for it. And sometimes it's pretty dramatic. And sometimes, as I'll show you here, it's as simple as my daily devotions. But I'm running through about two or three weeks of this kind of dilemma going on in my life when the phone rang and I got a call from a friend in another state. And I happen to know that this friend, for the last 11 years, gets anonymous letters. He's never known who it's coming from or where it comes from. It's never postmarked from the same place. He gets anonymous letters. I've been jealous of him. He gets anonymous letters that someone speaks into his life in written form and affirms what he's doing in his ministry and his life and then corrects him in some of the areas of his life. And my friend has told me several times, he said, this letter, I get one or two of these a year, and when they speak into my ministry, it's stuff that nobody knows. It's just been in the thoughts of my head. And he said, this person addresses that this letter addresses what nobody else knows, right on the money, and it's never been wrong one time in 11 years. And he's learned to live by that. And he said, oh, by the way, Leroy, he said, the last letter I got, your name is in it. And I'm going, yikes. Oh, no. Do I really want to know this? He said, I want to read it to you. And I said, I don't know where this letter comes from. I don't even know who this person is or how they know my name. I don't know nothing about it. But here's what he said. He read it to me. And as for Lee Ray, I have him exactly where I want him. Leave him alone. The air goes up on my back. Now, I can say, oh, well, that's nothing. I could. And the Bible does say, test the spirits, see whether it be of God. And sometimes you get crazy prophecies and you have to test them. But I know the background of this, and I know my friend, and I believe in his connection with God. And I've seen his wisdom. And when he read me that part of the letter, it intersected with the questions been going through my mind for 3 or 4 weeks. And I said, Lord, is this really you? Are you really in that letter? And the Spirit seemed to say to me, take it or leave it. But you've been asking the question. Here's your answer. And I decided to receive it as from the Lord, the confirmation of the Holy Spirit. Do you know what relief backs off on some of the questions and what I do on a daily basis? Because I just begin to live into that. Okay, Lord, if that's the case, then everything I'm facing and everything that I'm coming up against, you're in it. I don't have to wonder about this. And though I sometimes feel a churn in my gut about what's going on a daily basis, there is this peace that says, God's already told me till later notice, this is where I'm supposed to be. This is what I'm supposed to be doing. This is not a surprise. He's already in this. I was struggling with some things recently in another place in my life. And I said, Lord, I just need a confirmation. And so I'm reading through my devotions. And here's what came to me one day, right in the middle of my intersection of struggle. And I took it as from the Holy Spirit. Isaiah 41 is what I was reading. It said, Lee Ray, don't be afraid. I am with you. Don't be discouraged. I am your God. I'm going to strengthen you and help you. That's pretty good news, isn't it? And I'm going to hold you up with my victorious right hand. And I will guide you along the best pathway for your life. And I will advise you, and I will watch over you. Pretty good news, isn't it? I've been praying about the church. I said, Lord, you know, we need a building. I'm getting tired of going up and down, literally, in a hotel. We're up here, next week we're down, up, down. I've been doing this for 14 years. Spirit. And several times he's brought some buildings that we could go look at. And I've asked for so many things, and the answer was no. That I don't know about you, but you just get to the place, my Lord, if it works out, it works out, but I'm not going to ask you for it. I'm tired of asking and being disappointed. You ever felt like that? I'm tired of being disappointed. I'm not asking you for nothing anymore. You just do whatever you're going to do because that's what you're going to do anyway. And these thoughts are running through my head. And I go to my devotions. And that particular day, I didn't choose it. I didn't go looking for it. Here's what the Word of God said to me that day. Lee Ray, keep on asking. And you'll receive what you ask for. Well, I haven't in the last 14 years, Lord. Keep on asking. Remember Moses? He went up 10 times to Pharaoh. Keep on asking. Keep on seeking. Well, I'm getting tired of going looking at buildings that just turn out to be nothing. Keep on seeking and you will find. Keep on knocking. Well, I'm just tired of going and seeing what's listed, see if there's any possibility. I'm just tired of that. Keep on knocking and the door will be open to you, for everyone who asks receives. Well, when is that going to happen, Lord? Keep on asking, you'll receive. Everyone who seeks finds, and to everyone who knocks, the door will be open. Okay. I'll go look. I'll keep asking. How do you do that? The human spirit fails unless the Holy Spirit fills. Lord, I'm getting a little uncomfortable because I haven't had a chance to really share with somebody about Jesus in the last little while. Who is it that you're bringing? There's somebody that needs Jesus in my life. Last Halloween, Carson comes to our house. Now, I'm not real hepped on trick-or-treating, and I haven't done it in a long, long time, and Carson's going to go trick-or-treating, and he wants Papa to go trick-or-treating. And I'm going, I think I'll just hang out on my porch and hand out the candy. And there was a still small voice, a nudge of the Spirit that I've learned to cultivate. And he said, go with Carson and walk the streets. Okay. So I get up, I start down the block. I didn't get past the next door neighbor. Guess what? I've been praying for an opportunity to talk to them for a long, long time. And it's like, garage door down. Garage door up, back out, garage door down. That's about as far as it goes. I sent him a little, Lisa and I sent him a little Target card when they had a baby. Just congratulating them on their baby and sent him a little gift and said, hey, great to be your neighbor. We heard you have little Freddie was born and we can hardly wait to see him. Nudge of the Spirit. And I got next door and here they are, both of them. And they're out on their step with their bag, with their bowl of candy, and they're handing out their candy like everybody else in the neighborhood. And the street's full of everybody. And I walk up, and I introduce myself, and I introduce Carson, and he gets the candy. And, of course, he's on his way. But I sense they wanted to talk. So I begin to talk and build a relationship with them. And then, I wasn't ready for this. They said, so you're a pastor? Oh,
yeah, I'm a pastor.
And then she said, where's your church meet? So I told her about it. She says, we'd like to come. We've not been able to find a church. We'd like to come. And I could tell he wasn't real excited about that. And he kind of looks at her. We'd like to come to church sometime. And I said, we'd love to have you. And he said, oh, but we got to go visit relatives in Colorado next weekend. Okay. I haven't been able to have a conversation with them since, except garage door up, garage door down. But I don't believe I was able to talk to them about the changes and what greater life means. And we believe, what do you guys believe? Well, we believe that a person can have a life transforming relationship with Jesus Christ that changes everything in their life for the better and for good. Your kids would love it. We have people, I tell them about Juanita all the time. We got one of the best nursery workers. She loves kids like you can't believe. You. And she's in safe hands because she's a nurse. Oh, yeah. They're in for all that, see. I haven't had a conversation with them since. But the day is going to come. You know how I know that? Because the Holy Spirit nudges and is already working in their lives. Now, I can't see it yet. But I left a witness, and the Bible says the Holy Spirit prosecutes a witness with the witness. I wonder what would happen if you became aware of the work of the Holy Spirit in you, in your everyday living. Have you ever felt you got up one morning and you just had this thought? Don't go to work the same way that you go to work. Don't take the same route. Anybody ever had that? I have. Some of it I pass it off. But then I listen to see if it keeps coming back. See, I've learned that when the Holy Spirit is in it, He won't let me get away from it. He begins to impress and nudge. And he's not harsh, he's not pushy, but he's persistent. And if I'll tap into that, you say, well, what was that about? Well, sometimes he wants me to go a certain way, a different way, because I'm going to meet somebody that I wouldn't have met, and you'll know it. Sometimes I think he's helped me to avoid some accidents or stuff that I will never know till I get to heaven. But I've learned to listen. Well, that's kind of crazy. And you live with this voice in your head all the time? Just no. You learn to separate, test the spirits. And I've learned to separate what my thoughts are and to begin to recognize the nudges of the Spirit. What would happen if we had a whole church of people like that who lived in the nudges of the Spirit? Who became very conscious of the fact the human spirit fails unless the Holy Spirit fills. Have you allowed him to fill you? And let me tell you another secret. The Holy Spirit does not work in private alone. The Holy Spirit is a part of a small group. It's called the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They all work in community. And here's what God the Holy Spirit does. Many times he works through the community of believers in a small group or others in your life to confirm and to nudge. When I'm with some of you, I'm listening for the Spirit through you. Well, does that mean you believe everything everybody says? No. But I believe in you as the body of Christ, that you're part of the voice of the Holy Spirit into my life that becomes a part of the group. And sometimes I would never hear the Holy Spirit without you. That's why we talk at Greater Life, the need to be in a small group, to be in corporate worship. You see, some of you see what the church is, you just see it as a religious organization. You don't see it as a body of relationship for communication in the spiritual realm with the Spirit. You just come to church because that's the religious thing to do and because you want to be grateful for what God did for you, but you don't see the church and small group as literally being the life out of which you live in the Spirit. And until you do, it won't make any sense. But here's what's going to happen. You're going to miss what the Spirit's trying to say, because many times, as the Bible says in the book of Acts, here's what it constantly keeps saying, and the Spirit said to the church. And then you'll go a little further and it'll say, the disciples will say, and it seemed good to us, the church, and the Holy Spirit, that we should go do this. Well, isn't that what we elect a board for? Yeah, you know why we elect a board? We elect leaders who we trust will be filled with the Spirit and listening and moving in concert with the Spirit that begins to confirm what God wants to do through His church. Have you experienced it? What factors contribute to your feelings of inadequacy about imitating God's holiness? And if I went around the room this morning and asked you to list the ways that the Holy Spirit has specifically helped you and spoke into your life, would you be able to talk about anything? Well, the good news is you don't have to be a Catholic saint to get plugged into this. It's for every believer. Whosoever will, you cultivate it.